Now that we mentioned this, it's also important to say that there is no compulsion in religion, because that defeats the purpose of this world being a test for us. It says in the Holy Quran, Surah Baqarah, chapter 2, verse 256, "Let there be no compulsion in religion. Truth stands clear from error." So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says very clearly that do not force people to follow a certain way. What we see happening now with the Taliban and Swat and so on and so forth, it's not what Islam says. There is no compulsion. I cannot force anybody at gunpoint or any forcible measure to do anything. It is their choice. That's why it's a test. The choice completely lies with the person, and it's their responsibility whether they choose to believe or not to believe. Our job is to convey the message. If they accept it, brilliant. If they don't accept it, it's absolutely their choice. And that's why this word is a test. Now, you might ask that, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us so many proofs, there's so many evidences, all of these things over here. It's so obvious if you just, you know, read a little bit. Then why do people reject the message of Allah? Why do people shy away from it? Why do people shy away from Islam and the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? There are four reasons for it. The first one is arrogance. I make my own rules. Yes, I will do what I feel I want to do. You do not want to listen to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, that you must do this, you must do this, you must do this. You say, no. I know what is best for me. I. It's all arrogance. The biggest examples of arrogance that you will find in the Holy Quran, number one, Shaitan, number two, Fir'aun. Shaitan, who was in the presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked him to bow towards Adam. He said, no, I reject, I don't want to do this. He said, it's beneath me to do this. He was kicked out. Shaitan number one and Fir'aun number two. Fir'aun knew he was not God. He knew he had not created the galaxies and the planets and the sun and the moon. Yet he claimed that he was God. And he was treating people the same way. He had his own kingdom, he had his own rule. So these are the two people that you can find examples of arrogance in the Holy Quran. Fir'aun will be the one who will lead all the unbelievers into hell. He will be bearing the flag going into hell first, and everybody else follows him into hell. The second point is ignorance, that we are uneducated, we don't know. There is a lot of that we actually find it in Pakistan as well, especially in the villages. People don't know, they don't have the knowledge. It's our job to convey to them. They will go to the peers and the mazars and pray over there and ask every Tom, Dick and Harry for prayer and mercy and blessings and all, you know, everything except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that is ignorance, not knowing the truth. The third is having a don't care attitude towards it. I don't care. I don't really care. I'm happy with this world. Everything is fine. I've been leading my life for the last 25, 30 or 40 odd years. Everything is fine. Everything is fine. I'm happy. I don't want to change. I don't want to change my life. I don't care about this. I'm happy as it is. I have everything that I need right now, right here. I don't need any heaven or hell. I'm fine. They have a don't care attitude. They don't care about it. So that's the third reason. And the last reason is not being able to break away from the negative beliefs of their forefathers. Because their fathers did it and the father's fathers did it, so they don't want to break away from it. They always say, and it mentions in the Quran, they will always say that because they did it, we also do it. Without listening to any reason, logic whatsoever. So they will keep on doing their way. In the Holy Quran, it says again and again that although it is our job as Muslims to also, like I said in Surah Asr, the last 2 points were that you have to guide each other to the truth and guide each other to patience. But also the Holy Quran mentions that some people will not listen. Some people don't think that even if you try to, you know, convert everybody to the way of Islam, there will be many who will still not listen. The biggest example we have in the Holy Quran is that of the uncle of the Holy Prophet, Abu Talib, who till his death remained a kafir. He did not accept Islam, although the Holy Prophet tried to convert him himself. So there are people who will not accept. It says in the Holy Quran in Surah Al-Baqarah chapter 2 verse 18, Summun bukmun umyun fahum la yarji'un. Deaf, dumb and blind, they will not return to the straight path. It further mentioned in Surah Al-Baqarah chapter 2 verse 6 and Surah Yasin chapter 36 verse 10, as to those who reject faith, it is the same to them whether you warn them or do not warn them. They will not believe. Allah speaks about those who reject faith in Surah Al-Nahl, chapter 16, verse 107 and 108. He says, this is because they love the life of this world better than the hereafter, and Allah will not guide those who reject faith. Those are they whose hearts ears and eyes Allah has sealed, and they take no heed. So Allah Ta'ala mentions, see, Allah Ta'ala will facilitate you in everything that you do. You want to go to the good path, He will facilitate you. You walk towards Him, He'll run towards you. If you choose to take the other path and try to go away from Him, He will facilitate you in that. You will be in this quicksand, keep sinking and sinking and sinking in this illusion of this world that we have, and you'll never be able to get out. And that, believe me, is the worst punishment that a man would get. That he gets lost in his way, he gets lost in this, the path of the people who have actually gone astray. And in the end, he has to suffer the penalty for it. Because we know that this life is going to be over in a second. Over here we live 50 years, 60 years, 70 years, 80 years, maybe 100 years. That life is millions and millions of eternal life, millions and millions of years. So which is more important, this or that? This is what we need to figure out. This life, there is a sequence of people coming in. First the grandfather comes, then the father comes, then the son comes. But when you're exiting, there is no sequence. The son could go before the grandfather. The son could go before the father. Nobody can guarantee that, yes, I will be living till I'm 80 or until I'm 100. You don't know what the next moment can actually bring for you. And a true believer, as soon as death comes to him, he embraces it with open arms. Because he knows he has nothing to hide. Everything is open. His heart is pure. His heart is clean. And he accepts it. And he's looking forward to going to his Allah. But a non-believer, till the last minute, clings on to every worldly possession that he has. Till the last minute, he's struggling for something totally in the wrong direction. Now, we've spoken about the punishments, the world being detested, so on and so forth. Now, there is also a reward for the true believer. In Surah Al-Baqarah, chapter 2, verse 82, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, as for those who believe and lead a righteous life, they will be the dwellers of paradise. They will abide therein forever. So this is the reward for those who lead a righteous life and who have iman, that they will get paradise and they will stay there forever. And we will inshallah talk in future about what paradise is and so on and so forth. But in a nutshell, you can say it's the best of everything. What your heart has not even desired yet, that's what's in paradise. It's the most beautiful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's creations. And it's, this world does not even come close to paradise. Even if you get yourself the fanciest house, the best car, the best this, the best clothes, everything the best in the world, it will not even compare to the life that is there. So we need to put ourselves in perspective. We need to sort out our priorities and focus on the fact that what is more important for us, this world or that world? Because this world will be over in a flash. That world will remain forever. And that is the real test. The real test is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to sort out the good souls from the bad souls. And this world is the test. Finally, in the end, I would like to say that it is far better to lose out in this world, to go through hardships and pain and all of those bad things in this world, than to go through them in the hereafter. Because in the hereafter, it will be much, much worse. Much, much worse. And you know, we sometimes also say that, you know, people are born rich, people are born blind, some are born deaf and dumb, some break an arm or a leg or something like that. And we see that everybody is going about their own way. And we say, how could God be so unfair? I'm so rich and I'm living in a comfortable home and everything. And this poor chap, he's got, you know, he actually can't even see. And he doesn't even have legs. He's lost his family, so on and so forth. Believe me, the question paper that comes to everybody is different. You get tested in different ways. If I have money and I have a house and I have a car, I get tested in different ways. Because Allah Ta'ala will see, where did I spend my money? Where did I spend my time? Allah Ta'ala gave me education. What did I do with my education? Allah Ta'ala gave me strength. What did I do with my strength? Where did I put my effort and energies? Did I do it in something positive or something negative? In the same way, the person who is poor, he is exempt from some things. He does not have to worry about zakat. He does not need to give charity to anybody. He is exempt from doing hajj. He does not need to do that. He will not be asked about those two things. He will be asked about iman and how he actually persevered through all of this. But he is also exempt from a lot of things. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows, He has put different people in different conditions. But the test, the merit and the examination will be done according to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And He is the most just. The most just. I would like to end this with a dua. Rabbana atina fid dunya hasanatan wa fil akhirati hasanatan wa qina azabannar. O Allah, guide us to the absolute truth. Guide us to the straight path. Guide us to Siratul Mustaqim. Guide us to the path of those who earned your favor and not of those who've gone astray. O Allah, forgive us our sins, be they big or small. And in the hereafter, grant us the highest degree, the highest level of paradise. If you have any questions, you can please feel free to ask.